Can you sit down, please? And so I say like that, by the power of the blood, I invoke the power of the blood. I pull it, I go for it.
Amen.
Hey. And then in Kenya alone, more than 10 people go down and go.
Hallelujah!
More than 10 more. Big drama. They are not in a big market. It is drama, big drama. The power of the blood has big drama. It is the wonder.
Yes, it's
a and then I began to say for the first time in my life.
Oh, it's not nice to get a guy house.
I began to say, one of the first people I saw was a woman at Kenyatta National Hospital. Kenyatta National Hospital. Kenyatta National Hospital. I could see a woman there. And I could see that her hair, short hair. And the Lord was showing me, in fact, like, you hear me say, the Lord is now showing me her name. So, you could hear the conversation between the Lord and his servant live on radio. Because he was saying, oh, the Lord is now showing me her name. The Lord is now showing me her name. I don't know if there's a tumor or what. There was a woman there, the exact woman I could see, with a tumor in the neck. And the tumor strangled her, she cannot eat. Only fluids. The doctors prepared the knife. And I said, there is a woman I see. The Lord is now showing me your name. And I decree the tumor dissolve.
Amen.
That lady was listening to the prayer on radio inside the hospital. Because when the tumor hurt, the power du soir.
C'est pas le roi du camp, c'est pas le Dieu soir poste.
Then you must say to yourself,
let me go.
Who?
Hallelujah.
And you must say that. That was powerful. She said, when the tumor heard about the power of the blood of Jesus, the tumor said, no, let me go.
Amen.
Who am I to disobey the blood?
Amen.
If everybody, including Satan, is under the power of the blood, that is what the Lord has said to
Jesus.
He said, in this country, you know the power of the
blood.
Exodus 32, verse 32. pastor, I am going to be very short. He said this. God the Father himself has written a book.
He's
a gem. And that book, it is called a ledger, a register. It's a register. If you come to Finland, you go to the Ministry of Immigration or the Ministry of Home Affairs, I don't know which one it is. Ministry of Statistics, I don't know which one it is. If you go to that ministry, that government office, that office has a book. And inside that book, anybody that is finished, whether you are born yesterday, just born, born yesterday, your name is entered. It is a book that is a register of names of people that are finished people. It does not matter what your color is, as long as you're finished, your name is there. No, but listen to me now. He's saying that God in heaven has written a book, and he calls it the Lamb's Book of Life. And he says that book is a register, meaning it has a list. It is a register of the names of the citizens of heaven. Meaning that day when you come, I don't want to go. Okay, can I use your example, my son? Aaron. What is your name? Aaron. What is your name? Aaron. Okay. Aaron under A. This. Are you from Germany? Which country? Oh, from Finland. Okay, from Finland. Oh, I got you. Aaron, I got you. Go to room number 30B.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Because he said, there is a book. of all citizens of heaven.
Sono figli, io sono nuovo, anche sta paio a casa.
And he said, if you keep your garment finest linen, bright and clean, your name will be there.
E se la sanno, quando spina a poco, si chiama a poco, a perla a poco, si bisogna dire se non si ne ha.
That tells me that the righteousness that the garment announces, righteousness,
is
the most important thing in the church right now. That if you walk in that righteousness, your name will be maintained, maintained in the
book.
Because he says, I will not blot out your name. I will not remove it. That is, I will not. I will keep it there. That is powerful. So now look at this now. The garment for the coming of the Messiah. The righteousness that he is announcing for the coming of the Messiah. Has so much power. To keep your name in the book written in heaven and kept there. The register of God of all the righteous people. So there is a list. There is a register. Of all the righteous people. In fact, the citizens of heaven. Philip, are you coming? Why am I asking this? The reason I ask you whether you are coming is the following. That when the Messiah was pronounced by God in the book of Genesis chapter 3. I don't have time, I have only 20 minutes, 15 minutes. Can you follow me very close on this? I have only 15 minutes, then we take a break, but I need to give you something very powerful right now. Exodus chapter 3, verse 15. Don't worry about the lady, don't worry, the blood is powerful. Don't worry. The healing service here, right? Oh, yes. So, Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. Let me say this. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and the offspring of the woman. And he says, he will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. Philippa, can you focus on me? I have only 10 minutes. Focus on me. I have only 10 minutes. That when Adam and Eve fell to sin, when they fell to sin, then our God, our mighty God, he came out with plan B, redemption, salvation. And he announces here that the Messiah. The woman and the snake, they became friends. So he announced that he's going to break the friendship. He said, instead of friendship, I am going to bring enmity. I'm going to start a conflict between human beings and subjects. Because I've seen them become friends. And the serpent has lied to man. Lied. Focus. It's been a core vector of this very power. So, he said, to break that friendship, I have to put a conflict, a fight between these things. That's why he said, I will put everything between you and the woman, between your offspring and her offspring. Big and Satan internally. And he says that the true definition of Christian salvation that Jesus gave on the cross is that separation. That you be separated from sin. Tell me the people of
England.
He said that for you to be born again, when I look at your life, I must see that eternal conflict going on in your life. I must see that in your life, you are always fighting darkness. In your life, because you have the grace, you must fight corruption. This corruption is in the church. He's saying, in your life, when I look at your life, I will see that righteousness and wickedness are not mixed in your salvation. They cannot, and they are not mixed. He said, for as long as we maintain that eternal conflict between the grace and corruption, between holiness and ungodliness, between purity and immorality, when we maintain it, we are born again. Between corruption and the grace, between fidelity and immorality, between light and darkness. And he asks, how can light and darkness mix together? What does light have to do with darkness? He's saying, when we have that conflict continuing, that conflict, then we are born again. Because the salvation he brought us
is
called holy, holy. And in Hebrew, holy and separation. They share one root word. Say separate. That's why our God is holy, meaning he is set apart from the moral decay of this world. And he calls us to live a separated life for Jesus. So my question to Finland is this. I have talked about the glorious
garment,
the garment of righteousness, the garment of salvation, the garment of heaven, the garment of eternity, the garment of everlasting life, the garment of the Lord, the robes of Jesus, the robes of the Christ, the garment of the Christ. So my question to Finland is this. Are you aware? Is this beautiful nation, and Kenya, this nation is beautiful. Yesterday up to around 11 o'clock the sun is still on. Listen to me. In this beautiful nation, are you aware that there are only two garments, only two? There are three. Only two. Either you are wearing the garment of the Lord, either you are wearing the garment of Jehovah, the garment of the Lord, the other garment is worn by the harlot. The harlot. For me it's different. The other garment is worn by the harlot. The prostitute of Revelation. The harlot. For me it is different because recently the Lord showed me that woman. She was Don't deal with that. I can see that there's a very rough dealing involving those principles, those personalities. I know so much, but I'm talking about the church now, brother. The church that entered the cloud, glorious and entered. I want to focus on that. That you may enter. But I have seen the earth after the rapture, after the church is taken, I have seen what happens here. So don't worry about that. In fact, he has even introduced me some people. Some people that will play very important roles after the rapture. One of them is that woman of Christmas. In fact, the garment she is putting on purple. It is fine linen purple. Yes, but make sure you are there. Make sure you have good people looking at you. You see, so it is called fine linen, purple. That is the garment of Satan. There are only two garments in that in this book. Either you are wearing the garment of the Lord, which is finest linen, bright and clean. Or you are wearing the garment of Satan. It is fine linen and purple. If you go to Revelation, you will get Revelation 17. I don't have time to read it. Look at this now. Is the church in Finland aware that there are only two garments? Is the church in Slovenia, the church in Slovakia, the church in St. Petersburg, the church in Moscow, are you aware? The church in France, the church in the Netherlands, the church in Italy, Sweden, everywhere here, Netherlands, Amsterdam, wherever. Are you really aware in Denmark that there are only two garments? One is the garment of the Lord, and the other is the garment of Satan. But when I look at your light as the church in Finland, I see as if you are wearing a third. That's great. Why do I say so? Because the garment of the Lord is authority to transform life. I know. Because he said, when you wear the garment of salvation, that garment gives you beauty and glory, gives you dignity and honor.
You are broadcasting to the world that look, I am born again and
Then now the book of James, James chapter 4, verse 7 tells me, resist the devil, you flee. Now the devil runs away. He will run away from you because you have announced your stand. This is my stand. I am not going to change. If you are a woman, you have already announced to all the men that want to blast at you, don't try because I am born again. Because you are born again, but you go to secular movies. You are born again, but you are drinking wine. You are born again, but you are living with a woman and you are not married. You are born again, but you are dressing in such a way that you are exposing your body for men to lust at you. You are born again, but you are dressing in such a way that you don't seem to understand that your body is the holy temple of the Holy Spirit. You are born again, but there is abortions in the church. You are born again, but you seem to accept homosexuality a bit. That is mixing light with the darkness. That's why the Lord has sent me to the church in Finland and tell them, no, 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 you cannot mix light and
darkness.
The Lord has sent me to tell you that there will not be a modern Christian in heaven, no. But there will be a holy Christian in heaven. The Lord has sent me to tell you that for God so loved the world that He gave His only one and only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him, look at this now, will not perish. The Lord has sent me to read for you that scripture and to inform you that the power of the blood of Jesus is maximum. It has enough power to remove somebody from death with sin to eternal life. The Bible did not say, the Bible did not say that Jesus had only enough power to bring you to the middle. The Bible did not say that Jesus did not have enough power. But the Bible says that Jesus had enough power to remove us from darkness to light. To remove us from the world to the kingdom of God. So why is the church in Finland mixing the two?
Miksi seurakunta sitten Suomessa ja sekoitetaan nämä kaksi?
Did you understand?
Ymmärsitte.
Everybody rise up.
Kaikki nostaa
ylös. I will continue later. Did you understand, beloved people?
Amen.
I'm going to come back in the afternoon. I'm going to come back in the afternoon. And I'm going to share with you deeper, very deeper. There is a conversation I'm going to share with you, which is a secret prophecy. Secret. It's a prophecy that has secrets. How in 2004, on the 2nd of April, the Lord gave me a prophecy, which is a very complex prophecy, very big. Some of it is still being fulfilled. When he presented John the Baptist to speak with him in front of the throne of God, the glory covered the throne. Can you move closer, please? So, inside that vision, there are so many prophecies and they have been fulfilled. It's amazing. And inside that vision, you hear me say that at one point John the Baptist is transfigured. In transfiguration takes place
there.
And you hear me say that when I saw John the Baptist transfigured, when I looked at myself, I saw that I was also transfigured. Now, I never understood. I do not understand that part of the prophecy. The part where I saw many Christians going to Israel was fulfilled. The part where my daughter from Norway, wait a little bit. I know you were sitting in Norway at this way. This is a very important moment. You cannot. You can't try. Listen to this now. The part where I saw Benjamin Netanyahu becoming the Prime Minister of Israel, that part has been fulfilled. In fact, I used to say Benjamin Netanyahu too. Because the past one was in Israel. The part where now, thank you very much. The part, this part of transfiguration, I did not understand until this year. But you can see that that prophecy has chronological timeline of God. And I'm going to share that with you this evening as we go deeper to a few other conversations and then prepare for the grand mega conversation on the cloud of God that is switched off. Is up there. But the Lord has spoken to the church in Kenya today here. And he has said, apostasy in the church. Apostasy. The falling away from true faith. It represents the following. It represents rejecting God. Be very careful with her now. Move closer. Rejecting God. It represents abandoning God. It represents a rebellion against God. Rebellion. You don't want things doing God. This apostasy you see in the church in Finland today. It actually constitutes a rebellion by Jehová. Says, no, we don't want to glory your Lord. It represents a battle, but battle for the God sky battle. It represents refusing God. Let me read it here. It represents defiance against God. Rebellion against God. Abandoning God. Abandon. A revolt against God. A defection. If it's a political party and somebody defects, meaning he leaves that party, he joins another. Defection from God. It represents renouncing God. Renouncing, I have nothing to do with it. It represents rejecting God. It represents deserting God, meaning you leave him. Either we are with God or we are not. Because the Holy Spirit, He brought us wisdom into the grace of Jesus. And the grace of Jesus cannot be abused. I read Hebrews chapter 6, 4 to 6, warning on the abuse of the grace. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 26 to 31 is the same warning on abusing grace.